Adventure bikes are tall. Not all adventure riders are. What are the options if they need to lower the bike so they can touch the planet Earth?
Well, there's lots of options, and it starts with, first of all, determining how much you want to lower, how much you need to lower the motorcycle. That's the critical thing.
Well, how would they decide that?
So first you start with setting your sag. Very important. A 150-pound person wanting to lower an inch and a 350-pound person wanting to lower an inch, obviously two different things because of the sag. So you got to get your sag set properly. Once you do that, then you push it off the center stand, you sit on the motorcycle, and you start sliding boards under your feet. We like to use plywood because it's dimensional, right? Half-inch plywood is a half-inch. So we have stacks of this stuff we've gotten from the lumberyard, and it's free. They call it fall-off when they cut the lumber for the customers. And you bring this stuff home, and you start sliding it under your feet. You want the minimum amount of lowering necessary to make you happy. You don't want it because you're giving up something. You're giving up cornering clearance. You're giving up suspension travel. So you want to minimize it. This is not a case of if a little is good, more is better. We have had customers who've lowered their motorcycles, and then maybe they were new to the bike, and then maybe a year later, they call back and say, what can we do to lift the motorcycle back up? So that's another reason to not lower any more than is necessary. Maintain as much of your travel and clearance as you can. Once you get used to the motorcycle, you may not need as much lowering as you think you do. We actually had an F800 GS rider stop by not long ago. He was about 150 pounds. He wanted to lower his bike an inch and a half. And I asked him what his sag was. He said, I don't know. So we measured his sag. And what we learned was he only had about an inch of sag. Correct sag on that bike was 2.5 inches. One plus 1.5, right? So what it boiled down to was he actually didn't need lowering shocks. He actually needed correct sag. He was not heavy enough to compress the suspension on the motorcycle. Now, if I had not gotten that information from him, he may have just called and said, I want an inch and a half lower shock, and we would have sold him that, and it would have ended up being 3 inches lower, because the new shock will be set up for the guy's weight, plus be lower. So hopefully this makes sense. You have to start, what we're lowering from is correct sag. Okay, so you have to start at correct sag. If you're not heavy enough to compress the suspension, then you may be taller than correct sag. The seat height could be taller than correct sag. And let's say you're an inch and a half taller, and we get you down to correct sag, that's an inch and a half of lowering, but we didn't sell you lowering suspension.
What's the cheapest way for me to get that bike down, and then what's the best way to get it all the way down?
Well, the cheapest way is there are lowering springs on the market, okay? But you have to keep in mind how they work. A lowering spring, which we sell, will essentially cause excessive sag, okay? It'll drop the bike down further into its suspension travel. And they're inexpensive, so it'll get you there. The problem is, ask any suspension tuner what's the problem with riding around with excessive sag, and you're going to get an earful. Like, for example, if you were to back the preload out all the way and then put a whole bunch of weight on this bike to drop, to push the bike down to the ground, you'd be riding around with excessive sag. So they do work. Some people like them. Some people don't like them. But it is the lowest cost way of doing a tail lever bike.
Ted, what if I don't have a tail lever bike? What if I have a linkage motorcycle? What would I do then?
Yeah, so now you have another option, because the dog bones or the side plates, sometimes a combination, can be used to lower the motorcycle. By simply replacing those dog bones, the suspension will be lower. The thing is, you're still relying on your stock shock. Okay, what kind of condition is it in? How well does it work? You know, they're price point shocks to begin with. So, you know, you haven't
solved... It's not going to fix suspension,
right,
but it's going to fix the ride height.
That's exactly okay. Right. Now you've got to do something about the front, however. So that's a whole other topic of conversation, but how do we get the front end low to match the back end? And in some cases, you can simply push the triple clamps. If this is a telescopic fork bike, you can push the tubes up into the triple clamps.
But there's a problem with that, right? We can't just always loosen up the triple clamp and slide the forks through.
Exactly.
Right? What's going to happen?
Well, you have to consider the fact that, let's say you have 175 millimeters of travel in your front fork. That means that all those components down there that move are going to come up 175 millimeters. Now, if you took a tape measure and you put it on the fork brace or the fender and you went up 175 millimeters from full extension, up 175 millimeters, how much additional room do you have before the fender hits the radiator or something else? Do you have 5 millimeters? Do you have 35 millimeters? If you've only got 5 millimeters of room, after the suspension comes up its full amount, you can't raise the tubes and the triple clamps. Right. Then we can go inside the fork and we can add a spacer that limits the amount that the damper rod moves inside the fork. Essentially just moves the damper rod up, and then we have a shorter spring that fits to take up that space so that the front is lowered the same amount as the rear, so that the bike is balanced. That way your trail is correct up front. You don't want to turn it into a chopper. It's not going to want to go around turns. So you balance the bike by lowering equally front and rear.
And certainly that's really important when we lower a bike, that we're not just dropping the back of the bike or the front of the bike. It has to be done in concert. They need to match on both sides so that our rake and trail and our stability of the motorcycle is correct when we're off-road,
and the overall handling. And then, of course, if you have a toe lever bike, the better way to lower the motorcycle is with shorter suspension. So the shocks are literally shorter. For example, if you have a GS Adventure, you can go down to GS height. If you have a GS, you can go down to GS low height, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, there are even some really low options out there that I think were originally designed for the Asian market, but just smaller people, small guys, women, et cetera, you can take it down pretty low. The thing you have to watch out for, though, of course, is you're giving up cornering clearance, you're giving up ground clearance, there's no free lunch here, and then you're going to have to shorten up your stands.